Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the next session. It is titled Future Cities, a Balancing Act, where we'll be discussing the future of Colombo as a city. I have a wonderful panel with me, and I'm really looking forward to hearing what they have to say about what the future holds for the city of Colombo. For many of you, Colombo is home. It's a place that is incredibly diverse, with its inhabitants ranging the spectrum of ethnicity, religion, class. It's a place of contradictions, dilemmas, its own set of complexities that we hope to confront during the next 1.5 hours. But above all, I think it's a place that inspires hope, that is a beacon of sorts, which attracts those with dreams and aspirations. So for many of us, we'd like to know what the future holds for Colombo. And during the next 1.5 hours, we're going to hear from Madhura Premathilake, who I'll be introducing in a moment, Ajitha de Costa, and Naomi Hanakata. A little bit about the session and how I'd like to structure it. We'll begin with some opening remarks from our panelists, and then move into a slightly more conversational mode. And I'd like to give you all ample opportunity to ask your questions as well. Anyway, Madhura is the principal of TA, Team Architrev. He is an architect and urban designer. He studied architecture at Morotu and Helsinki and has worked in a number of countries, including Sri Lanka, Finland, India, China, Oman, and the Maldives. He has lectured and taught extensively at international conferences and universities. He's also won numerous design awards, and his work is published internationally. So let me begin this session by inviting Madhura to share his opening remarks.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Okay, thanks. Thank you. Thank you for not sparing me that embarrassment. Okay, we're going to talk about Colombo basically, and urban, in terms of urban development, urban space. Something I thought it's good to have a look at what's happened in the recent past, and then move on to what options we have for the present and the future. One thing I have to tell you is that this discussion is going to be political. So, because urban change is inherently political, and urban spaces are produced by political agendas, be they democratic, which is rare, or autocratic, which is more frequent. So let's take a look at what's been happening in Colombo over the last 5 or 6 years, basically post-war. Nothing, obviously. Okay, so we all know these places. We all know these places. We have parks and squares, and we have walking and jogging paths. We have places for urbanites to indulge in fitness, bird watch, go to the flower market and the floating market. Now, it was called beautification. And I think that's a wrong term because it indicates a certain superficiality. But these are genuinely good, useful, reasonably well-designed public spaces and civic spaces. And I think we should all agree that these were great things for the city of Colombo. However, my opinion is that it was all the right things done for all the wrong reasons and using the wrong processes. a lot of this was done for the glorification of the regime. And urban design was used as spectacle and intoxicant. It was not only used to consolidate the regime's popularity, but also to distract from other things that were going on. And it was a centralized process, very centralized, without any public participation, public consultation, or even public awareness. Someone up there decided that this was good for us, and it was given to us. Good thing most of us tend to agree, but there have been instances where the wrong thing was done. Now, this is not unique. It has happened many times before. Some of the greatest public spaces in the world, the boulevards of Paris, were created by this kind of top-down process. And there was this guy with this in the caricature with a spade, a planner called Haussmann, who cut through vast areas of people's houses and places of work to create what are now the boulevards of Paris. So this is and it was a completely top-down process. Now we celebrate these avenues as some of the great public spaces of the world. The other thing is that Colombo's fine new public spaces were created by the military, maintained by the military, and policed by the military. And even glorified the military. I don't know of any other public space in the world where we have a tank sitting in the middle of the park. And it was part of the overall encroaching of militarization into civilian life. Now, there is still probably a school of thought which says that the military did it well, they maintained it well, they're efficient, and that's the only way to get things done. If you walk around these places, they're not maintained by the military anymore. And after initial hiccups, they seem to be reasonably well maintained. And as for policing, when public spaces are created in response to people's needs and with people's awareness and participation, they themselves will take care of it. That's part of the process of growing up and being a city dweller, of claiming ownership of these places, not having it dictated to you by someone in uniform. The other aspect of urban development over the last 5-6 years is, of course, the big development schemes, which although brought in investment, also created this issue of displacement of people. And I think, Gehan, you probably know more about this than I do, so I'm not going to talk. And it's been discussed both here previously and in other fora in Colomboscope. Just to mention that this was a very strong issue, and also about what we do going forward from here, because displacement of people, moving the urban poor, the urban working class out of critical inner city areas is such a common phenomenon in urban development. And when we move forward from here, the things that are going to happen from here shouldn't create and replace this displacement with another kind of displacement, that we should have a more inclusive process of planning and places for the urban poor, who are the backbone of urban society, in these plans that we create. So I think I will leave it at that.
Thank you very much. I think that raises a few questions that I would like to ask during the next phase of the conversation, and I'm sure many of the audience members will also have questions for you. Let's hear from Ajit. Let me quickly introduce him and embarrass him as well. He's a chartered textile technologist by profession and is currently managing director of Maxim Group of Companies. He is also the chairman of the Ceylon Agro Development Company Limited and the Heritage Foundation for the Environment and Arts. He was a founder member and chairman of the Sri Lanka Apparel Exporters Association and has served on the Fauna and Flora Advisory Committee, National Environmental Council, and Advisory Council for National Zoological Gardens. I'm sure you're aware of the fact that he's also the chairman of the Western Regional Megapolis Project and is tasked with producing a physical plan for the Western region of Sri Lanka with an emphasis on the environment. Ajit.
Good morning, everyone. Actually, I don't know how I ended up being chairman of the Western Region Megapolis when I really should be running my factory. But be that as it may, here we are. The history of this project goes back to 2002-2003 when the then Prime Minister, who is also the current Prime Minister, and was very friendly with Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew, had decided to get down the SESMA planning people from Singapore to take a look at how we should develop in a sort of planned manner the Western region, which extends from Digambo to Kalutara and up to Avisabel on the other side. And in comparison with Singapore, which is about 600 square kilometers, the Western region is 3,600 square kilometers. In this 3,600 square kilometers, 30% is actually natural assets of water bodies, paddy fields, and even forests, like in Kalutara. So we are endowed with a very fine set of physical assets and natural assets. The plan that was submitted in 2002-2003 was set aside by the government because there was a change of government, and they went into what the UDA now calls ad hocism. So there was ad hoc buildings here, there. Somebody decides to pave a road, and that's what they've been doing. The SESPA people are now recommissioned to visit Sri Lanka. They will arrive probably sometime next week, and they'll do what is called a sort of walkthrough audit to see what's left of the area that they had planned to have various projects. And we are hoping that at the end of all of 3, maximum 4 months, we'll have a nice plan. We will go public. In fact, we are inclusive, because we are on Facebook, we are talking to even young people. The other day, a young boy of 16 phoned me and he said, can I talk to you? And if I criticize the plan, will I be taken away to be questioned by the CID? So I said, no, we don't have white vans, but we do have a couple of old double cabs. And with that, and next week we are going to have a little presentation with the young people. We are going to work with the National Youth Services Council in Maragama, because after all, it's going to be their city, and they need to be involved in the planning process. That's the way it's going to be. Thank you.
Thank you, Ajitha. Let me first apologize on behalf of the organizers. We had Dr. Remo Burkhardt, who was initially a panelist for this session, but due to unavoidable circumstances and some personal issues, he had to pull out. But we're not too disappointed, because we have Naomi with us here today. And let me quickly introduce Naomi before she makes some opening remarks. She's an architect and an urban designer and an urban researcher at the ETH Future Cities Laboratory of the Singapore ETH Center. Her research focuses on urbanization processes and in around megacity regions and their implication on a local and global scale. Currently, her research is focused on the debate around sustainable future cities with a research project called Thinking Urban Futures. Naomi, your opening remarks.
Thank you, Gehan. I'm sorry. It's quite windy up here.
It is.
Thank you very much for letting me part of this. So my expertise is kind of limited when it comes to Colombo, but I'm happy to take this discussion really towards the future and maybe have it around what a future scenario of Colombo could be, what a sustainable future scenario for Colombo could be. I think that's where it becomes interesting. And here, I think it does not hurt to remind ourselves to quickly recall what would it really mean if we are thinking of sustainable urban, future urban scenarios, and remind ourselves that sustainability really is never a condition, is never a status of whether it's a project or even a city, but it can only ever be a wish, a hypothesis for something, right? Because some time really needs to pass for us to be able to observe whether the prediction of something being sustainable or not holds true. So if we aim for something sustainable, we constantly have to work on. It's never something done or that a box that can be ticked, but it's something we have to continuously work on every day and remind ourselves what are the goals we are aiming for, what are the sustainable goals we set ourselves for, let's say a city, and work on that with every single project we choose to work on. So a sustainable development really is a development that at the same time meets the needs of the people living in the present right now without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. And I think that's something, even though we might have heard that term so many times over and over again, I don't think it hurts to recall, to remind ourselves that it's something we constantly have to work on, and it concerns the present as well as the future. And here I think we also have to remind ourselves that it's a very complex matter. And I think we should not be afraid of thinking about it in a very, you know, multidimensional way. We, as urban planners, we cannot just look at the urban scale in terms of, you know, its morphology or mobility structure, infrastructure. But we equally have to think of the economic dimension. We have to think of the cultural dimension, and obviously all that together in the social dimension. And because it all is ultimately very tightly connected. And nowadays, we kind of easily sort of withdraw ourselves to our realms of expertise in which, you know, we're forced to by profession. We're all forced to be experts. We are demanded to know everything about a little, you know, field, with the consequence that we kind of tend to ignore many fields that are equally connected. So I'm always making a call to not be afraid of thinking comprehensively on various dimensions. But that's obviously also something we cannot do alone, right? We always have to collaborate. We have to communicate with different professions at the same time. And that's, again, where a dialogue like we're having it here today is super crucial. Luckily, we're kind of related professions here. Apart from you, which makes it even more so interesting. But especially when it crosses professions, I think it's crucial that we don't take it for granted to be able to communicate, but we have to invest time and effort to be able to communicate with different professions, but also increasingly so moving forward between different cultures. Because again, looking at a sustainable development is not only something that is relevant on a long time scale, but also on a wide geographical scale. We cannot just look at a city. We always have to look at the region and its global network. And I think that's also where Colombo is actually a very interesting case, and I'm very much looking forward to discussion. Thank you, Gehan.
Thank you, Naomi. Let's start with Madhura. Can I ask you what your favorite feature of Colombo is, just to get a sense of who the person is we're speaking to? And maybe your fondest memory of Colombo?
Sorry?
Your fondest memory of Colombo? Like, what do you really like about Colombo?
You know, these questions are staged.
Of course they are.
We had a little chat and he told us he was going to ask this question. So he asked me to work out what my favorite part of Colombo is. So whenever I have an important question to answer, I always ask my wife. So I asked her, what's my favorite part?
Where is she?
I've lived in Colombo since I was 19 or something. So, and I'm pretty old now. So, and I live in the city. I don't like living in suburbs. I like to live in the city. So we've lived in various places in the city. And what really is important about living in a city is that you have everything within walking distance. And Colombo has a series of neighborhoods which work like that, which is one of the nicest features of the city. I presently live in an area of Colombo where within a 5-minute walk I can find 21, and I'm still counting, 21 restaurants and cafes. It's in Colombo 5. So the ability to walk to places, to have streets where you can walk. And the interesting thing about Colombo is that there is always such a mix. We have we live on a nice lane with a broad street, but right at the top of the street where it falls on, connects to the main road, there is someone who's kind of encroached. There's always the mandatory set of three-wheelers parked there, and they're the guys who are the kind of the eyes who keep lookout on everything. This mix, this ability to constantly have a mix of social groupings, of activities, of this formal and informal. Those guys are probably squatting on the land, but they have political clout, and successive regimes have not been able to move them out of there, even the last one. So it's a very interesting facet of Colombo, this mix. And that's, I think, something we mustn't lose in the rush to plan. Because we over-plan and we get rid of all the things which happen incidentally. And we lose an essential part of the city. So that's a favorite memory.
Ajit, can I ask the same question for you?
I don't live in Colombo because I don't like Colombo. So I live in Pitakote, and my house faces the marsh. And every morning I wake up to the sound of birds. There are cormorants. I mean, there are, I think, 60-odd varieties of birds right in front of me. And there's a little canal, which was originally a marsh, and then it became a canal during the last government. They decided to dredge it, and then we had boats going up and down, which was a bit of a nuisance, but now the weeds have taken over and nature has taken over, and I wake up to that beautiful sight every day. The fact that I don't like, I'm not like him, he's been born, oh no, you were born in Kandy, no? That's right, sorry, he was born in Kandy. But he lived 19 odd years or something, since 19 here in Colombo. I prefer to live out of Colombo. I spend most of my time, most weekends, now if not for today, of this young band convincing me to come here, I would have been in Boondala watching birds, or in Haputale or some such place. That's what I do. Okay, thanks.
Naomi, I think it'll be unfair for me to ask you about your favorite memory of Colombo, but what are your first impressions?
That's a tricky one since I really just got here yesterday. But I think let's put it that way. I'm intrigued to know more about how the city, the relation of the city is to the rest of the country. It has a huge, vast hinterland and a big neighbor, so it has a very particular situation in the larger region of South Asia, and I think a very is in a position with a lot of potential with regards to that very unique kind of setting. So I'm curious to see how it's taking advantage of that potential.
All right, Madhura, I think you mentioned that you were on the panel or similar panel last year at Colomboscope discussing a similar issue. And I'm really curious as to how the conversation has changed. Has it changed at all, or are there now elephants in the room that can be actually addressed? How has it changed since last year?
I think that's the issue. The last time, everybody knew there was an elephant in the room, but nobody was willing to say so, because you would say so at certain risk. But it's really interesting that Colomboscope, the timing is impeccable, I think, that it is happening now at this point of potential change, where we could move things forward. So the discussion last time was at a time when there was no way we expected any change to happen. And it was unthinkable that we would be at this point a year or the next session. It was in February 2014. So the big change is what has happened outside the room than inside the room, and we need to start reacting to that. Can I say something else?
Sure.
I watch birds too, and in Colombo 5. And they're the feathered variety.
Ajitha, I wonder if I could ask you, your strengths are in environmental sustainability, and that's really the reason you're planning the future of the city, in a sense, because there is this emphasis on environmental sustainability. What do you see as the major challenges from that perspective going into the next 5-10 years?
I think garbage is a huge problem, the waste management. We need also, for especially the lower middle class urban population, to be able to separate and to be educated on that thing. The government has set up or will be setting up a waste to energy plant. They've given the authority, that it's been finalized, and it will be on stream in about 2 years. It's third generation, state of the art Japanese technology. So all garbage will be sorted out. But till then we have a problem. But I believe in the last 1 week, we managed to convince the local authorities to start collecting the garbage, and they were shoving it in a place called Meetotamulla. I think that is one huge problem.
Just continuing on that line, as chairman of this project, your initial focus is going to be on Colombo and the Western Province. What are the risks of Colombo being an exceptional case, this kind of exceptionalism where they get the city gets more attention than some of the other cities in Sri Lanka, particularly in the north and in the center? Is there a real risk that there will be exceptionalism?
Yeah, I wouldn't say Colombo. I would like to refer to it as the Western region. Now, the Western region is specially blessed because most of the natural assets of this country is in the Western region. Most other parts are dry apart from Kandy. But if you look, I mean, we've got the sea. We've got 30% of the Western region is the beautiful water bodies like what you have in front here, the wetlands, the marshes, and paddy fields. It's also where all or most of the jobs are generated. So loads of factories in Colombo or in the larger, in the Western region. So there's a huge migration which we are now debating on how to solve. One way is to create, we've identified Horana, to create some sort of townships there and new industries, give investments to industries to move out there. Also Ragama, for instance, there's about 450 acres that can be used up there. And we also thinking of moving out the prisons, 130 acres, no? Prison, yeah. Move the prison out to Koggal or someplace like that. And so make this a very livable city, you know. It is very livable, it's quite livable right now, but we want to make it that much more livable with planned spaces, yeah?
Maybe can I just quickly jump onto this question? I'm curious, so you mentioned you have a focus on the western region, but I'm curious the actual extent of the region you're considering within your plans and projects. And then, because you're also saying you're currently dealing with a very high congestion and a population increase within the Colombo region, right? So what are your attempts and ideas for how to deal with that in the future if you're only looking at the western region rather than the, let's say, entire country? Or even beyond that?
Yeah, for the first 3 months, we'll be looking only at the western region. And then after that, we've been asked to move to the rest of the country. We're going to move to Jaffna in about 4 weeks from now. And look at Jaffna before it also explodes into some kind of sprawl. Jaffna is very special because it's got a problem of water, it's got a limestone layer, it's got you know, stopped in history, like years ago. It's a very special place. We're also going to start with Trincomalee, which is also a special, very special place. And the thing is, all this is going to be looked at from an environment point of view. And we are not going to let anything happen without an EIA. In fact, we are going to do what is called a strategic environment assessment of the Megapolis project itself. And we've started that process. And that will throw up areas where certain projects cannot be implemented. Certain projects will be completely not allowed to take place. We're looking at it from an environment point of view, which is very important, right?
Yep.
Madhura, you had a question. Yep.
No, I think it, obviously more than just from an environmental point of view. I mean, I can just give you, tell from my experience with Tokyo, which is a mega city region I'm looking particularly close at, which has about 42 million inhabitants. And where right now it's very obvious how especially the periphery is tremendously struggling with the fact that all attention and investment is again, after some decades where it was different, again all focusing on the central area which concerns about 13 million people, but where now the periphery is not only suffering from disinvestment but also from largely the elderly population being left behind, because now it's again possible for younger people to move to find housing in the central area. So, you know, the dialectic dynamic between the center and the periphery is so obvious and so strong, even in a large city like Tokyo, that I'm sure, it must be very strong in a relatively small city and in region like Colombo as well.
Yeah, I think you're right. We've started studying the Gampa district, which is the largest in the western region. And there's a funny phenomena which we are trying to understand, and we've got the University of the Colombo University dons on those subjects working on it. The older population has moved to the periphery of the Gampa district. And the younger, so the parents are, we don't know why, I mean we'll know in about 3 weeks, we've started the questionnaire, they've gone out on a survey, and the younger guys are towards the road, towards the sea and all that. I would imagine it's also something to do with jobs, and also the cost of living, and they probably have ancestral homes, at the periphery, yeah. And also in this country we have an extended family system which is working, you know, we have very few orphanages and sort of homes for the elderly because we take care of our elderly, right? Like in your country. Mm-hmm.
Madhura, you had a question.
Yes. Ajitha, I was instrumental in getting you here. I didn't tell you were going to be the punching bag. Just a clarification. How does the Western Region Megapolis fit into a national physical development plan? Because obviously there is a national physical development plan, or there was. And within that, the particular role of the Western Region as the kind of engine of growth and how it relates to the hinterland would be identified.
Yeah, well, the national physical plan is about 30 years old, as you know.
Right. I thought we had a national physical planning department, which is
we have a national physical planning department, but the plan is 30 years old,
okay.
Right? The Western region is, right, like you quite rightly said, going to be the engine of growth, and is we have to bring in certain mechanisms to deal with the migration from the outside the Western region to the Western region, and one way is to create jobs outside, right? But this plan that we're doing is based on a population of about 8 to 8.5 million, including the working population that travels to the thing, yeah, in 15 years. And so the public spaces and all that will be based on that kind of population growth, you know. Having said that, I think we are then moving on to the other cities. We will make them as livable as possible, and there will be less opportunities for industrial growth there, because for instance, Trincomalee has its special assets. Hambantota has been developed, there's very little land available to do anything there now. Kandy is very congested, as you know. You come from Kandy. It has a huge problem with pollution. I mean, the Kandy Lake is still receiving all the sewage. But I'm told that in about a year's time, that problem will be solved, because the World Bank has given a huge loan for a sewage treatment plant, and so on. So because of the last 15 years of non-environmentally related projects, we are now faced with this problem, and this garbage is one thing. I mean, one could just, you don't see garbage on the road because it's collected, but it's been managed badly, and we are hoping to sort that out. So answers your question.
Before we open it up to the audience, Naomi, Singapore's been held out to be the gold standard as far as Sri Lanka and Colombo is concerned. Is this the right direction for us to go in?
Oh, I think you better be very careful with that one. I mean, generally, I think you have to be very careful with taking any kind of other city as a reference or even model. Not only because you have to, you know, look very careful of what you're taking as a model, and not only pick the cherries, but look at the conditions and the circumstances under which, let's say, Singapore has achieved what it has achieved over the last 50 years. But I think even more so, and that applies to a much larger scale, is because the conditions and parameters are always very specific. It's not that we cannot learn certain lessons from various other cities, but to generally take a city as a model, I'd be very careful with. And because obviously in the case of Singapore, it's not only this very unique geographical condition of being an island, a city-state, but probably more significantly so, its very particular governmental situation, which I think you are rather happy to have sort of moved on, or let's say to the next level here in Sri Lanka. I think that's something to be very proud of at this point. So I'm sure there are lessons we can learn from Singapore, But generally taking as a model, I advise to be rather critical.
Any of you want to weigh in on that before we go into the audience session? Nope? Okay. We have about, I think, 15 minutes left. I'm happy to hear a few questions. I'll take them in clusters, maybe. And if you can, if you don't mind introducing yourself, that'd be great. We have mics going around, or are you going to have to add? Okay, doesn't look like it. Let's start with the lady in front. I'm happy to. Oh, there's a mic coming. Yep.
Yeah. Hi. My name is Deepali. I'm an architect. I just wanted to ask Mr. DeCosta, what is the emphasis that the Western Region Megapolis Plan will place on public transport, which is absolutely, I think, not garbage. Garbage is not such a big problem. The biggest problem is public transport for the people of this city who come from Gaul and Kandy and Nigambo on a daily commute, and they travel in horrendous conditions. So how is the Western Megapolis Plan going to address this?
Okay, let's take two more questions. I see Vijay at the back, and there's someone in front here as well.
Thank you very much. One question, but partly related to what Deepali raised. But I'm also surprised to hear, Mr. DeCosta, you say that the National Physical Plan is 30 years old, because it is not. The Town Country Planning Ordinance was amended, and the National Physical Planning Council only set up in 2000. The Technical Advisory Committees were set up in 2001, and the plan itself was only adopted in 2006. So the plan is actually less than 10 years old. Though there was talk of a National Physical Plan for a long time, the plan itself is in fact quite recent. And in the National Physical Plan, there is already sub-plans for 5 metropolitan regions, including the Western Metropolitan Region. And so my first question was, how does the Western Megapolis planning project sit with what is embedded in the National Physical Plan already, and the work that happened on the National Physical Plan between the years 2006 and 2015? The second question is also connected to Deepali's, which is that there's also a Colombo Transport Master Plan, which was submitted to the government last August, which is now being revised, I understand. In fact, the National Physical Plan is also being updated. So how does the Western Region Megapolis planning project sit with the Colombo Transport Master Plan that's in fact already ready and it's being revised? My concern is that it seems like what happened between the years 2010 to 2015, when the UDA was under the, when the urban development was under the Ministry of Defense, we see the same sort of ad hocism post January 2015 in terms of the way planning has proceeded. The Western Region Megapolis has been pulled out of the draw, and we see it being rolled out in phases, but there's very little democratic consultation. I'm afraid I don't see Facebook equals democratic participation. There needs to be far more work that we need to do in terms of participation. The World Bank, with the Metro Colombo Urban Development Project, had so-called public consultations, where for 1.5 hours, we were meant to discuss some, 16 volumes of, reports. It's just not realistic. So I think we really need some much more robust mechanisms of consultation and participation, meaningful consultation and participation. But most importantly, we need these plans to speak to each other. I was actually part of a meeting in one of the ministries very relevant to the plan, Western Region Megapolis Project. And in front of me, the secretary was making calls, asking other secretaries whether they knew something about the Western Region Megapolis Plan. And I had to tell him that one of the departments he thought would have information actually didn't have the information, because I happened to know it from another secretary. So I think there's a real urgent need to address communication within the government, as well as communication between government and citizens.
Thanks, Vijay. Let's take one more question and perhaps have, I think Ajitha, unfortunately, is in the firing line already. Let's take one more question. I think there was a lady in row 4. And then we'll come back to you, sir. Just over here. Yeah.
Hi, so my question is also along the same lines. Essentially, with the Mahindra Chintana vision for the future, that was the national physical planning policy that was used from 2010 and was supposed to lead on to 2030. And at that time, that's not the focus of my question, but that was a UNDP-led project which actually mapped the whole of Sri Lanka. And it put all of the different economic zones, environmental, disaster risk, all in one analysis. And I was just curious whether that's going to be used for the Western Megapolis, regional Megapolis project, and also whether it would incorporate the other plans as well, because like Vijaya said, actually, I'm aware there's, you have the Western Metropolitan Colombo Urban Development Plan as well, and whether these are all being meshed together, you know, where you have the mapping analysis as a basis for these urban planning programs.
Thank you. I'm just going to ask, when you're asking a question, be as loud as possible, because I get a sense that people in the back don't quite hear you. But I think Ajitha did pick that question up. Maybe you want to weigh in, and then we'll take another round of questions.
Yeah, the thing is that we are less than 1 month into this process. We are still collecting the persons who are, you know, the experts to work with us. We've got a fair amount right now. Fair amount of them are working with us, but we are not complete yet. That's number one. Number two, I think you should give us a little chance for this to start working, because in the last, I don't agree with that, the other gentleman there, there may have been a plan, but it was all ad hocism. I can't see because the Urban Development Authority told me that there was no plan that they were working on over the last 10 years. So I don't know what they told you, right? As far as the Megapolis is concerned, we are going into consultation with as many people as possible. I gave you an example of Facebook as just an example, but we are all inclusive. We've been in the media, we've been on the radio, we've been on television, and asking people to interact with us. Now I can't force people to interact with us, but everyone is welcome. We have an open, every Wednesday we have an open day. People walk in from all over the place and they want a presentation. We have maps, we have everything that is ready there. Anyone here wishes to come? We are on the 10th floor of the Seth Siripaya new building. We just walk in. And there's a huge board saying a Megapolis project. And so we are all open, our doors are open, and anyone can walk in. And we are as inclusive as we can be. As far as the transport plan, I'm aware of it, and I'm also aware that it's being, I've seen the presentation. And Madhura, if nothing is done regarding transport, in 5 years, the average speed in Colombo will be 5.5 kilometers an hour, which is just over walking speed. You know? So I've seen the plan, and they're working on it. They're looking at a monorail system, or the possibility of a dedicated public transport lane for public transport. They're looking at all, and there has been a JICA study on it as well. You must be aware of that. Yeah. So nobody's doing nothing. They're all working on it, and we are hoping in 3 months we'll have something to expose to the world. Okay. Thanks.
Thanks, Ajitha. There's a gentleman in front that had a question, and then there's Sheeny at the back. And there's another question over there. Can we get the mic over here, if you don't mind? I'm happy to donate a mic, by the way.
Before I give it to him, I want to ask Ajitha, how are you going to finance this? You're the chairman of the Megapolis, so we have to ask you. How are you going to finance this? This looks like a pie in the sky to me.
Shall we take a couple more questions and then, okay. Right at the back, there's someone who's already got a mic, so for your decisiveness, you get to ask the question.
Hi, my name is Kanishka.
My question is, I thought
two mics, is it?
I thought you asked me to ask the question.
Oh, okay, right. I thought your wife asked a question for you.
No, she's my sister. She always bosses me. My question is, sir, we obviously have got to depend on foreign investment to enhance Colombo and the Western Province. We simply don't have the money to do it on our own. Now, my question is, if you want to, we are already saying we attract foreign investment and we will compete with the other nations in South Asia to attract that capital. Now, if you let capital dictate the policies of urban enhancement, history tells us that the inhabitants of a capital or the lower middle class, the working class, will be all rooted out because they'll be priced out. Now my question is, will the government or the planners like yourself, sir, make sure that the policy protects these people? That's what makes a city vibrant, when you have all sorts of people living together. And would you make sure that kind of environment is included in your plan, rather than leave your plan to be dictated by capital coming from abroad, like in London, like in New York, and earlier speaker said, like in Bombay? So please answer my question, sir.
Okay, let's get one more question, and I'm going to have Ajitha, maybe also Naomi weighing in, because your research might be able to shed some light on some of these same questions. Okay, you've got the mic.
The question is very similar to the last one. It really has to do with if your plan is actually going to take policy into account when it comes to, we've seen a large number of very expensive developments in the center, and we all know that the big problem with traffic is that if everyone lives in Rajagiri and, you know, 10, 20 miles outside of the center of the city and they're coming in, traffic gets a lot worse. So for young professionals who can't afford to buy in the city, the key is to provide affordable housing in the center. Now, there are no policies in place, as far as I know, that allow us to buy towards the center of the city, and people build, you know, 50-story apartment blocks. Like in London and places, there's no proportion, say 15% affordable housing has to be provided. And what we're seeing is a lot of affordable housing being provided much further afield, which exacerbates the transport problem. So my question is, are there lobby groups? Is there something in your plan to account for this?
All right, so obviously the questions are coming in your direction, but I'd also like Naomi to maybe speak a little bit about her research, and some of these questions could also be answered in terms of experiences elsewhere, because as Ajitha mentioned, the plan is still quite new, and perhaps experiences elsewhere could in fact help us understand where to go.
Do you want to give a response first, or?
Like I mentioned, we haven't finished the plan. In fact, we just started it a few weeks ago. We are giving due consideration to say slum dwellers. For instance, as you know, what happened at Vauxhall Street is not going to happen again, right? We've started a process of brainstorming with the financial institutions within the government on how to make the slum dwellers homeowners, say in a large complex, and they're coming up with some very interesting theories and solutions. So, I would like all of you, anyone who's interested, say in a month's time, to pop in over to our office, and you'll see how the progress we are doing. Obviously, you are very interested in that, and you're extremely welcome to the Megapolis project office. Okay.
I'm wondering whether you could also comment on the financing aspect, because I think there was a couple of questions that were directed on the financing aspect.
I think there's enough money in this country to finance this project, because this is not going to be done in 2 years. It's going to be done over 20 to 25 years. That's number one. There is a fair amount of grey and black money, and we're talking to the finance ministry on how to attract that. because I am told that the black market and the grey market is about four times the size of our national budget. So that's how large it is. Now, if we can get that money, we don't have to go out. If you can get that kind of money, right?
Maybe just a very general comment at this point. I mean, first, I think it's a very exciting phase Colombo is in right now with a lot of potentials, and it's all about taking advantage of that, right? And I think what has been alluded to earlier is also just stressing one point again. I mean, having the possibility of participatory planning is one thing, but I think what is crucial and should not be big news is to actually have mechanisms in place that make it transparent and see where this participatory planning goes, right? I mean, being able to criticize or comment on agendas or plans, or actually help to shape them to different things, right? And I think this is what would be the ideal scenario to have mechanisms in place that ensure that this is happening, right? That people feel that their opinion, their comments are actually reflected in what is happening, and whether that includes the question of housing or infrastructure. I mean, it really concerns all the different dimensions. And it's a big challenge.
We had some questions at the back. I think we'll start with Sheenie right at the end, and then this gentleman over here, and Patrick.
Hi, so my name is Shehani. My question is actually to the whole panel here. Two questions. First is, I think Gehan mentioned that, you know, Singapore is the gold standard for this type of thing. But Singapore is vastly different in terms of the tax brackets and the type of per head overhead that this kind of infrastructure has. And if that's the case, how does Colombo aspire to be a Singapore without really transferring that burden on its citizens? The second question is, I think you mentioned that transport-wise, you're planning to have a massive plan. I think, but it's barely sufficient to suggest that there will be lanes for public transport. I think there has to be a concerted effort at introducing sustainable transportation methods, hybrid buses, to different ways in people can travel without bringing their cars into Colombo. Do you have a plan for that? And how do you actually plan to involve different stakeholders into that conversation?
Thanks. There's a gentleman over here. Four rows from the back, yep. Just here, yep.
Ragi Kadirgama, architect, former advisor to the Minister of Urban Development. It's a statement and a couple of questions, and I know both these gentlemen very well, and I'm pleased to see our friend here from Singapore. Is there room in what you're doing at the moment to question whether a megapolis is actually desirable, number one? Number two, we've come out of an era of conflict where centralization has been one of the main causes of that conflict, and we're going straight back into that. So is there a chance that, given the scope of what's happening here with the city and the Western Province in relation to the rest of the country, that we can avoid some of those mistakes? And finally, if we keep looking at it in terms of waste and transport and other housing, other important issues, yes, they're important issues for the city, but no city, as our friend from Singapore will know, is isolated from the rest of the country. And we have a unique opportunity here in Sri Lanka to actually leap over some of the typical mistakes cities around the world have made over 30 years. And Singapore's no exception. I lived and worked there in the early 90s. And if we don't do it now, we're embarking on a period of mistakes, which are going to be very costly and could cause more stress and more problems in the years to come. So it's an open question. I'd like to also hear, particularly because Madhura is very modest, I know that from personal experience working with him, what your vision might be, Madhura, if you were in charge. Not to say that Ajitha is not the best man, I think he probably is, and I wish he had a wider scope to look at the whole of the country in the first 3 months and not just the Western Province. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Patrick, you want to just ask your question and let's hear from Madhura. Okay. Patrick's given the baton to you immediately.
This extremely hypothetical question, Ragi, the answer is I would call you. many moons ago, we worked on a plan together for Colombo, and you were doing the most of the work. I was just tagging on behind. And the idea was that the city of Colombo could be planned on the basis of green and blue. Natural vegetation, the continuity of open spaces and natural vegetation and water bodies. And while I'm saying it, I recognize the significance of a green and blue plan as we stand today. But that's just for Colombo. I think there are a lot of questions coming up here which are asking about transport, about sustainability, about the relationship between the Western region and the rest of the country. And the point is, we are at very early days. The planning institution has barely functioned in a couple of months. The planning process itself is just underway. But I think the most important thing that is coming out here, as Naomi remarked, is that we need to have a mechanism for public transparency in the process. Otherwise, as it was remarked, we will go back to a centralized planning process and all of us professionals, and particularly planners, tend to be rather territorial about what they do, because it's a lot of work. And once the work is done, you don't want somebody messing it up, so you try to deliver a done deal, a finished product. But it's the process of participation is also not defined. We are not used to a responsible participation. It's quite easy to shoot a smart question and then walk away. So it's two sides of the coin, and we need to now move in as a society into a phase where we are responsible in the way we open ourselves to being questioned, and responsible in the way we question as well. That's something that we all have to do if we are interested in the well-being of this city and this country.
On that question of responsibility, there was a question that was raised, I think, at the back by Shehani about how important it would be to shift the responsibility to the citizenry as well, and that if you're looking at Singapore as a standard to aspire to, it also comes with the burden of taxation. I'm wondering whether any of you would like to comment on that.
Well, not only with the burden of taxation, but also with, with a very limited responsibility when it comes to the citizens of Singapore, right? And I think that's also something this learning process you were alluding to, it's something, you know, everyone has to be patient with, because it's really a learning process. It's not something that can be switched on, or just because now you have the opportunities you ask, questions will come. And just because questions might come at some point, it doesn't mean that, you know, they fall on fertile ground necessarily. But it's a process. And I think on both sides, on the planner sides as well as on the citizen sides, who ideally have the chance to get involved, you should not want too much at the very first day, right? But it's bear in mind that it's a long path, and it's never finished. It should never be finished.
Thanks, Naomi. Patrick, and then another question from the front.
Is it on? Yeah. Okay. Thanks. My name is Patrick, and I love Pita Kote, and I love Colombo too, actually. I want to come back to that title of the session, The Balancing Act. And I will refer to what happened to people of Slave Island, the evictions. For those of you who have gone to Rio and have gone to the first floor and have seen what International Alert is explaining there. Basically, I understand that there is a need to have standards for social safeguards, environment safeguards. I've seen in Colombo one side of Beira Lake with that benefited from a loan from World Bank, and we have the World Bank social and environment safeguard. Other side of Beira Lake, things happened and very different kind of safeguards, if any. So we're not only speaking about the need to have common safeguard in Colombo, but also, you know, nationally, and how do we go about it? And I'm trying to link this to something you said, Madhura, about getting the people involved. And you said something like people could be involved even in maintaining. And I don't know how far, you know, I'd like you to comment a bit more about people participation. Naomi, thank you very much for saying that in Singapore, because we were speaking, several speakers spoke about Singapore, but my goodness, how far did the people of Singapore contribute, you know, effectively and in a participatory way? So how do we go on over this balancing act or getting people involved? And now, I'll finish with this. So many people have been moved from Save Island, and they are now in flats. She showed us a picture of Paris. Paris, you've seen what happened in Paris. All these people in these towers, and all these social problems, etc., and conflict, and so. So look like we're going the same direction. Can we still do something for the people of Slave Island who are in the towers? Any suggestion? There are only a few courageous people. I think people from CPA, from SEPA, International, you know, during under the previous regime, who spoke out. Now the elephant is in the room, but somehow it seems that there is room, there is opportunity, room for maneuver with the elephant in the room. So can we speak out? Can we do something? Can we still correct what has been done to the people of who have been evicted from Slave Island?
Thank you. There's another question in front.
Getting back to this idea of public participation. Informally, if you make it too informal, you're not going to get much of a result. People are not really going to walk into the office and give you suggestions. But there are processes by which you can formalize the participation process. Of course, one of the biggest lacuna that the UDA faces is the sheer lack of data. They don't have updated GIS plans that include sociological data, nothing of the sort. They are working on a GIS plan, but it's based on a survey plan of 2001, so we are really behind the times here. So how do you plan when the UDA itself doesn't have anything up to date on which to make a plan? If you look at how Singapore does it, they have an online planning database which is updated in real time, which gives its citizens all the information it needs on every plot of land, every transport interlink, and it seems to be working because it keeps everybody on the same page. There's great transparency, and this is what we need to set up at the UDA. It's not about planning. Everybody can plan. It's about creating systems by which this plan can be read and understood and added to and modified by the entire city.
Thank you. Vijay, I hope it's short. Okay, good.
I mean, I think there's a good reason why there's a lot of anxiety about this plan, and it's because of the experience of the last 5 years since 2010. I work for the Center for Poverty Analysis. My colleagues from CPA are here. I mean, for us simply to hold the ground in the face of the juggernaut that was the UDA over the last 5 years has been extraordinarily difficult. And hence, you know, the questions that have arisen about the Western Region Megapolis planning process. Because it's also, for us, the key things that were missing are the question of equity and the question of rights in the context of planning. If the planning process becomes a technocracy, which we then revisit once it's done after several months, like Madhura, you were saying, then the framework for even us to engage with the plan is actually very minimal because it's all done. That's how the UDA gave us their thing. It was all cooked. You know, we just had to sort of deal with it, which we are now, you know, been struggling to, you know, deal with. So I think our concern is really in terms of creating very, very robust mechanisms of participation very early on, when concerns of equity and concerns of rights, particularly in terms of whose megapolis is it anyways? I mean, if we need a megapolis, whose is it? Is it that large section of Colombo, you know, who are very vulnerable and, you know, spatially and economically marginalized? If it is also theirs, then we really need rights and equity to be at the heart of this process. And that needs very, very robust mechanisms of participation from the get-go.
Thanks, Vijay. Perhaps Ajitha and then maybe Madhura would want to weigh in.
Can I first invite you to join us as an advisor, please? 0777-301-481, telephone number. I'll be very happy to have you on board. And you too, Rage, nice to see you after. I thought you were in the Himalayas or something, meditating. But nice to see you're back here. Join us. Yeah? Regarding public transport, the transport department is doing a good job. They're weighing three or four possibilities. We got a huge problem at Rajagiriya. The traffic at Rajagiriya is really unbelievable. And the Spanish government has offered us an overhead thing like in Nugegoda. But we've asked that it be put on hold for a few months till the plan is done, because if you do that, you can't have a monorail going that way with that. So I think we put up with that traffic jam for so many years, another 3 months should be okay. Anything else?
I think Madhura had something to say.
About the question of public participation, maybe I wasn't clear enough. What I meant was that if there is public consultation, if people's opinions and views are taken into account in the process of planning and creating public space, then people will have a better sense of ownership, and maybe they don't need to be policed about the way they use it. That's what I meant. Not that people will take their equal broom and go and sweep it, but that they won't put the litter there in the first place. And the other question about Slave Island, which is a very, very valid question, I think Gehan is more qualified than any of us to answer that issue of displaced people and what can be done about it, even at this stage.
I think you're putting me on the spot, but I'm not a panelist, I'm the moderator. that's naughty of you. But then I think we have a few people who can comment on that. I want to actually go into that issue, because you said something interesting when we were conversing before the session, that urban planning cannot be divorced from the politics of planning. And my research goes into involuntary resettlement and the fact that we've had this policy in place that has never been really implemented apart from projects that were funded by specific agencies. And it's a national policy that's fairly good. But when it came to the evictions of people in Slave Island, this policy wasn't applied. So it raises the interesting question for researchers and rights activists whether policies become optional because they don't have the force of law, and they don't have, there's no obligation that can be enforced in terms of our expectations. So I do think that that is a problem, but I want to kind of direct the question back at you and ask the question, when you ran your slides and you raised the issue of militarization and the past, when you look into the future, how much of the past should be reflected in that? And particularly from perspective of an architect, how much of our recent history should be embedded in the architecture of the city? And I'm sure this is something that you and Tenu would have explored last year, but is there an opportunity now to really take that seriously and have the architecture of the city actually be shaped in a way that reflects our recent quite dark history?
How much time do we have?
We have about six minutes, or 10 minutes. We have 10 minutes. Okay. Excellent.
Very, very simply. if you're asking for architecture is a mirror of society as much as planning is. And if you look at the public buildings that were built during the last say 5-6 years, you see this. For example, the race course was refurbished and brought back to a really splendid state. And that's a building that I've been looking at since I was an architecture student and wanting someone to wishing that someone would bring it back. And it happened. And a lot of things happened which are things that I've always wished for. But right next to it was built an identical replica, a kind of race course patia, if you like, or aya. So here we have a building which was built, what, 75, 80 years ago, and another one which was built yesterday, which is indistinguishable from each other. And this neoclassical kind of pastiche seemed to be the flavor of the day. And because it was the flavor of the regime, it became also favored by people who would even private developers. So it became a filtering down of cultural preferences. And it's not unusual for this style to be adopted because it's always been this neoclassical pastiche has always been the preferred style of dictators. That's evident in history. So because it has order, it's no nonsense, and it has formality, and so there are various kind of identities about it which make it preferred. Now and it's a great pity, and I think as architects need to take a lot of responsibility for this, because while on the one hand we have architecture which is celebrated all over the world, that is limited very, very largely to the private realm. We produce fantastic buildings which are private buildings, but we do not get involved, or we do not have the opportunity to get involved in public buildings. And in terms of architecture, I think Sri Lanka really needs to create, as it has done in the private realm, create an identity of contemporary Sri Lankan architecture in the public realm, which we have not done. We have completely failed in that. And we either have these neoclassical make-believes, or we have glass boxes. And we have completely failed in that. So, guilty.
What would you like to see in the future? If you take the project, for example, how should it integrate some of these gaps, these problems going forward?
Well, I think that the key would be to have an emphasis on urban design, because the urban design is a sphere of activity which has been missing in our planning and production processes. We have the planning and we jump into building design. We do not create neighborhoods, we do not define how one building relates to another, we do not design streets. And I believe that is happening now in the Megapolis project. So that's a very crucial area which needs to be brought into the process of producing the built environment.
Thanks. Well, we can take one more question, or maybe, yeah, Bhavani, maybe two more questions, and let's have the panelists offer their final remarks and close up. Bhavani.
Bhavani from CPA. I just want to come back to the topic of this session, which says balancing act, and I value the points raised, but I think the point that Vijay also raised about equity rights and the whole issue of dignity, because we monitor the situation of displacement in Sri Lanka, but specifically in Colombo with the evictions, and this was very much lacking under the previous regime. And moving forward, it's not a question, it's moving forward, how do you correct some of the wrongs that happened? And what are the policies and practices that should be taken on board? specifically on the ground. We can talk about, you know, the office being set up somewhere on the 10th floor and people can come for consultations, but what actually happens to those who are evicted? Those who were dragged out of their houses, saw their houses being demolished. I mean, it was a very traumatic experience. We take it for granted that we have our home and we can live there without any danger. But these are the issues, I think, on the ground that needs to be addressed. And going back to the question about the policies, I mean, Gehan, myself, there's been so many who've been pushing for the NERP to be actually implemented and given teeth. But let's not forget there is a legal framework in Sri Lanka. So actually, let's think about what's actually in place. And how do you not just say it's a legal framework, but make it more practical for the people? So just not to forget that balancing means there's a bigger picture. It's not just economics and development. There are human beings whose lives and livelihoods, identity need to be recognized. And I hope this discussion today and tomorrow recognize the bigger pictures. It's not just about development.
Thank you a lot, Babani. Any other?
This is it's cliche, but it is a kind of beginning now for all of us. And the amount of interest and the kind of passion there is about the city is very important. So I'm sorry to have to say this, Ajitha, but it kind of boils down to you. I know you're off to see an important person right after this meeting, and you need to carry this message with you. I think that there is so much interest in this, and there needs to be a very formal, clear, easily accessed mechanism for people to get involved, to see what you're doing, and to comment on what you're doing. And it needs to be structured. That would make the real difference between the past and the present. Otherwise, it will be another version of the past.
Final comments? Or you've spoken enough today?
Like I said, we want to be all inclusive. We'd like... Oh, he's gone. Oh, no, he's there. I'd like him to join us in the project. I'd like Ragi to join us too, because Ragi knows all about this. We learn as...
Have some women too.
Pardon?
Have some women too.
Yeah, but for some... Well, we have one. We have Hiranti. We've got one. For some reason, we don't seem to be attracting women. I don't know why.
Because it's not naturally going to happen, and if so, maybe only a very small group of people. But to really cultivate this practice of participation is also something that where work and effort needs to be invested in.
I just want to thank the panelists. It was a wonderful and fascinating conversation, and thank you very much for your participation as well. We're going to close the session. The next session is at 12 o'clock. It's called Narrating City Lives. Please stick around for it. Thank you very much.